Well, welcome to Pasco Nazarene. Happy St. Patrick's Day. We do have the guest of honor with us today, St. Patty, you know. Say, there she is, our St. Patty of Pasco Nazarene right there, doing a little jig for you back there. So congratulations on your special day, Patty. You're welcome. You're welcome. Let's stand together and worship the Lord. Here's a song that brings back the Old Testament story of Elijah. If you're unfamiliar with that story, it could be confusing to you, this song.
Are you done?
I'm done. One another. Welcome.
Good morning.
Morning. No, I'm trying to sing high, but sometimes I'm coming down.
Thank you.
All right, if you did not wear green today, please come line up front for public humiliation. We're going to do a pinching line. No, that's weird. Just Mike.
I don't know, Pastor. Your shirt looks blue in this light.
No, I have proof, and I've done this like a million times today, but green sock. There's green on those trees on my sock. It is sad. I don't wear a lot of green. Welcome to middle school, everyone. If you open up your bulletin, we're going to walk through a couple things. If I can get mine open. A couple things. The dates to remember for Easter are in here. And so you want to know our Palm Sunday, Good Friday. For Palm Sunday, the kids are going to be doing a song. It's going to be awesome. Probably. I don't know. I'm not in there. It'll probably be really awesome. Right? Sandy loves my announcements. There's some save the dates in here for our marriage conference. There's a comedy night coming up for U Medical. We have district assembly coming up. There is all sorts of good stuff in here. We also wanted to say a big thank you to those who came out and helped with our work day yesterday. If you haven't seen it, there is a cross on the side of the gym. And if you don't have a very good imagination, it looks like this, but metal. Right? It's really, really cool. Thank you for all your hard work. We had people painting in here. We filled up a dump trailer with stuff. We did all sorts of stuff. So thank you, thank you, thank you for all your help. Not too many announcements today. We're pretty good. Like I said, fair warning. Today we are having Eric preach about health sermon. Preach. Healthy bodies is what I told you. And I was like, man, I really don't want to preach on that. Who could I ask? No, I kid. But like I told you, stop eating donuts 3 weeks ago. So if you didn't listen, that's on you. Let's pray as we come into our service. Jesus, we love to have fun. We love to just talk about the things going on in your body. And Lord, as we come in today, as we continue to worship you, Lord, may your presence be close today. So, Lord, as the ushers come forward to receive the offering, and as we continue to worship you, Lord, may you just bless this service. In your name we pray, Jesus. Amen.
I won't forget. Of my heart, you found me, you freed me.
Goodness of God.
As we come into our prayer time today, we've been in a healthy living series. We've talked about healthy spiritual lives. We've talked about the need for forgiveness, for overcoming addiction in our lives, for healthy mental health. And today we're going to hear about healthy bodies, but I hope that God has been working on your heart in this time when we've been talking about what it means to live a healthy life. And that God is calling us to live healthy lives. So as we come into this prayer time, if you want to come to the altars are always open. But if not, you may take a seat where you're at and make an altar there in your heart. And Jesus, we are thankful. Lord, thank you for the kids as they're walking out. Lord, what an amazing energy they bring. We're so blessed to have them. And Jesus, as we think about what it means to be healthy, Lord, we know that you want us to be healthy in heart, soul, mind, and body. And Jesus, as we've talked and processed, it's brought up some tough questions in people's lives. It's maybe identified some areas where we could continue to work on our own health. And Jesus, today may you shine a light into our heart. Lord, if there's an area that you want us to work on, may we be open to hearing words of wisdom and truth. Jesus, we are so thankful. Lord, whatever we walked in here with today, whatever stresses, whatever burdens, whatever things we carry, Jesus, may we lay them at your feet. And know, Lord, that you love us. That God, you cherish us, that you are enough. So Jesus, may we surrender our baggage, may we surrender our burdens. And Jesus, we are blessed to get to come and worship you today. Lord, in your precious and in your powerful name we pray. Amen. Well, today we get to have a guest speaker in Pastor Chaplain Eric. Lord Reverend Pastor Chaplain? Oh, there we go. This is the first time I've gotten to actually hear you preach. Last time I had Eric preach for me, I was like, oh, great, I'm going to watch online, and then you cut the power. Yeah, to the whole church. Just all the lights, everything. If you weren't here, neither was I. But Eric, I'm excited to hear you today.
I'm excited to hear me.
Yeah, there you go. Well, welcome, Eric, and take it away.
I'm going to come down here because this is more friendly, and I decided that I'm going to sit, and I don't normally sit when I am in front of people for all kinds of reasons. Sorry there, Mike, I'm messing up your music. Sorry, Sherry. I don't normally sit for all kinds of reasons, but today I just feel compelled to. I have sat and preached. I've been doing ministry like this, preaching ministry, chaplaincy, pastoral ministry for like almost 30 years now. And I think I've sat to preach one other time. And it was memorable. It was probably one of the, that was a good sermon. Okay. And I was going to sit up there and I thought, how can you folks see me? I'm going to be down below things, but maybe you don't want to see me after this sermon. Right? All right, and my lovely wife, Kim, assured me that this would not flip. It is pretty stable. And I also understand that I've got, like, until 11:30. I hope I don't use all that time. Ooh, nobody likes a long-winded preacher. I don't. But my theology and philosophy of homiletics, that's the art of preaching, is not this sermon. That's a different sermon. Okay. And I can't believe you even came today knowing what the topic was. Crazy, right? Just crazy land. I have in here, I've written myself notes. I don't normally preach just off of notes. I usually have a written text. And I'm gonna address that in just a minute. But before then, I've got a whole bunch of things. My brain is going in 1,000 different directions. I'm going to let you in this morning to my brain. Whew. Right? Very courageous. I'll tell you who this is courageous on. It's not it's courageous on my part to let you into it, because it's all over the place. And that's, I think, probably why I'm sitting, why I felt like I needed to sit. Because the last time I did this, I felt like I needed to sit. And then afterward, well, I'll tell a few of you maybe afterward what happened when I preached like this the first time. And I'll explain to you, I think, too, in here, the difference between a sermon and preaching. It's down there, too. First, though, I want to open this with this word of Jesus. Jesus says, you have eyes to see, but do not see. So my hope for you this morning and for me is that by the time we're all done, that we see a little bit better. Okay? And let's pray. Father, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be pleasing to you. You are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I'm going to pull some words out of, is this too much of that? Good? Okay. Are there people watching online? Hi, online folks. 1 John, John 1, chapter 4, 1 through 4. 1 John 4, 1 through 4. He says this, he says, dear friends, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits to see whether they are from God, because many false prophets have come out into the world. This is how you can recognize the Spirit of God. Every spirit that acknowledges that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. But every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of the Antichrist, which you have heard is coming, and even now is already in the world. You, dear children, are from God and have overcome them, because the one who is in you is greater than the one who is in the world. They are from the world, and therefore speak from the point of the world, and the world listens to them. We are from God, and whoever knows God listens to us, but whoever is not from God does not listen to us. This is how we recognize the spirit of truth and the spirit of falsehood. The part I want you to take away from this passage is that Jesus came in the flesh, and that greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. So keep those two pieces in mind. And if you have like a pen or pencil or something, you want to write some notes, maybe something cogent falls out of my mouth, you want to write it down, this is the time to do it. You are getting the experience of all of these years. Do I need to tell them what I do, Pastor Jeb? Okay, I'm a prison chaplain. I've been a prison chaplain for 21 years. I'm also an outdoor adventure recreation chaplain. There's a specific title to it, but I'll just leave that for other people. And I did pastoral ministry for about 7 years before that, and have all the credentials and all these things that everybody wants, and lots of education, lots and lots of education. And I don't think I actually started getting educated till I went to prison. And that was long after my formal education. That was long after the degrees were hung on the wall, right? Until I actually started working with people. That's really when my education started, especially people that weren't that friendly. And interestingly, it wasn't in prison that I didn't find friendly people. I had 7 years of pastoral ministry in the church before that. So you guys do the math. So I... this morning, I really don't know how to do this. Pastor Jeb gave me this topic and asked me to do it, and I was like, absolutely. And then I was like, oh my gosh, I said it before I realized what in the world was happening. I was excited and all of that. Thank you, Pastor Jeb, for bringing attention to mental health, spiritual health, emotional health, and physical health. That is an excellent shepherd of the sheep. Yeah, who wants a flock of sheep that can barely get around, stumbling, banging into things, right? Well done, Pastor. Thank you. So I really don't know how to do this. I was struggling with it for quite a while, and then I thought, you know what? I just need to let these people into my head. Now, if you ever ask my wife, well, you can see the look on her face. She's like, oh my. This could go anywhere. But I did write notes, sweetheart, to keep me on track. Although I'm already three ahead because I was supposed to talk up Pastor Jeb for bringing attention to health and wellness. I already did that, and I still have two other points to get to. So I'm going to be preaching this morning, not giving you a sermon. And I was just sharing with Pastor Jeb a little bit ago what I think the difference is. A sermon, I think, is something that that's at least for me, it's typically centered around Scripture. I'm not a big fan of topical sermons. It's centered typically around Scripture, and I prepare it, and then I deliver it. And for me, it's like I write it out. I make sure that all of my words are right. Oh, that they just sound beautiful to my ears, and then I let them out, right, in this prepared way. Well, that's not going to be this morning. This morning, I'm going to be what I think of as like preaching, and that's kind of what you're getting right now. Could go in multiple directions. If I get out of hand, you settle me down. Thank you. Could go in multiple directions. We're going to see. So I'm going to let you in on my mind, my ruminations, some of the things that I ruminate on, some of the things that I've spent decades kind of carousing and filing in and getting fine-tuned into some ways of thinking and living and being as a man of God, as women of God, as children of God. And so I'm going to let you in on some of that. Oh, it says here, introduce yourself, share a little about your own physical habits and the history of those physical habits. Oh, dear. Well, there will be some sometimes awkward pauses because I'm going to be thinking, right? And I'm watching the clock. It's only 11:02. So, and I know the rules. I already know the rules. I already know the rules. I can cut off at any time. I think I really started getting my head around the love of physical exercise, gosh, quite a few years ago when I was going to go into the Navy as a chaplain. That was my intention, was going to the Navy as a chaplain. I had to get ready for the tests and everything like this. Well, that ended up falling through for multiple reasons, but I continued to exercise. And over the course of years, my physical exercise, it's gone this direction and this direction and this direction. But because of the way my mind is wired, which, as you can tell already, is kind of higgly-piggly, and anybody who has been around me very long knows that I can just about keep a rein on myself, and that's about it. Just about. I don't really keep a full rein on myself. It's just about a rein on myself. So exercise really helps that. It helps me to stay focused. It helps me to kind of get some of that energy out. And for whatever reason, it's really resonated with me, and I've enjoyed it. And I continue to enjoy it. And now I continue to enjoy it for both intrinsic and extrinsic reasons, because my physical exercise and the things I do for the way I eat and train for allow me to do fun and adventurous things, right? So I have some outside reasons why I really love the way I eat and move, and some inside reasons about why I love to eat and move. If you want to know even more in detail about me and my physical habits and eating habits, just, you know, hang around me for a little bit and I'll fill you in at some point. They're kind of crazy, some of them. Oh, yes. We are to be shaped by the resurrection and the new heaven and the new earth. We are called to introduce, bear witness to the kingdom of God that is among us. Ooh. So, back to the scripture. Jesus came in the flesh. Where do I talk about? Oh, yeah, I talk about the rapture right there. Ooh, that's going to be hard for folks to hear, Pastor Jeb. They're not going to like it. Oh, by the way, and I didn't say this before, this is a freebie. I know that there are oftentimes honorariums and stipends for pastors that come and speak. Today's a freebie for you, no charge. And if you already wrote the check, you get it back. Because then it's like, you know, no harm, no foul, right? So, I thought, oh my gosh, I can't make him give me any money. Not after today. You know, I'm a climber. I'm an alpinist, vertical rock stuff. And one of my climbing heroes, she said, she does what she does. She pushes her body. She's crazy. I'm crazy. She's really crazy. She pushes her body to the nth degree, she said, as a physical worship to God. Because God gave her this body, and in every possible way she can, she's going to use what she's been given. She didn't want to take a gift and just sit it aside and never use it. What kind of shameful thing would that be? If you got something so precious that somebody else really loved, gave it to you, and then you just kind of ignored it. And she's from the Carolinas. So, you know, gift given in the South is serious business, right? It's like eggs and grits. Yeah. Jesus came in the flesh. Jesus was fully human. This morning I want us to really get, if you have anything to take away today, I want you to know and I want you to remember that you are actually human in flesh. You are actually person in flesh. You're not just spirit. This isn't just a skin sack. Those are things I love to hear. I don't love to hear, but those are things I hear in media or in social, right, on the gram. It's just a skin sack. Can't wait to get out of it. Well, if you are a follower of the way of Jesus, you are more than just a spirit waiting to escape this thing. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that when I talk about the rapture. Ooh. Oh my gosh, I'm going to step on toes. I can't believe you guys came this morning. So, if we are followers of Jesus, and we actually say, and Easter is just around the corner. What is it? The 31st? Yeah. We're right in the middle of Lent. And we take that seriously. Jesus coming into the flesh is just a microcosm of the larger macrocosm of God being present in the world. Jesus is just the discrete example of that so that we can see and touch and feel. But God's imminently, ubiquitously present, you know, commonly present. God is in, God's everywhere. And Jesus just exemplifies that, right? In the most readily available form for us to understand. And now here we are too, right? In flesh, really real. And what do we do with that? What do we do with that? What do we do with that God's presence in this world and us really, really being really flesh? How do we see that? You know, do we have eyes to see but don't see? A lot of this stuff is just going to go over y'all's head. Just take what you can. Okay? Or it's not even over your head. It's going to go beside your head, maybe under your head. Right? Just take what you can. Glean what you can. If you get like one good word out of the whole thing, take home with you. That's good enough. If you just don't like, you know, tar and feather me, that's good enough. The bodily resurrection of Jesus is an affirmation of just how good this creation is, including your body, including you, the stuff right here, right? All those things you don't like when you look in the mirror. All those ways you overjudge yourself or chastise yourself. Right? Anywhere on that spectrum. It is an affirmation. The bodily resurrection of Jesus is an affirmation of just how good this creation is, and that we bear witness to the resurrection. Listen to this. We bear witness to the resurrection of Jesus, not by our testimony, not by this, but by our witness, by what we do. Our testimony is just a big flapping lip. I am so sick of words. If I never hear one more word out of a person's mouth, it would just be too soon. I'd like to see some action. I'd like to see some behavior. I'd like to see some witness. Right? Testimony, what's coming out of our mouth. Witness, what our lives are growing into and look like. Right? I don't care a whit about you telling me that you are saved. I don't care a whit about you telling me that you are sanctified. I don't care. I do not care at all. Don't you ever tell me any of those things. I'd love to see it, though. Right? I'd love to see that you are saved. I would love to see that the Holy Spirit is residing in you, sanctifying you day by day. And if I never hear a word about it out of your mouth, it's going to be too soon, too. I don't ever want to hear it. Don't you ever tell me. You picking up what I'm laying down on that? Yeah. Yeah. Two different things, testimony and witness. But then what's our witness looking like? What's that active lived out life looking like, especially when it's in regard to our healthy bodies or unhealthy bodies or where we are in that journey of body experience, like living in this thing, this enfleshment of God's gift to me that now I just need to use up, because why would I leave a wonderful, beautiful gift sitting on the side, right? You know how when you give somebody a gift and you're all excited about it and they look at it, oh my gosh, that's so nice, and then they set it aside and they never touch it again? Oh my gosh, right? Broken heart. We gave our daughter, our oldest daughter, a couple $100 for Christmas to put toward a piano that she was saving up for because she's a pianist. She's out on her own, living in Portland. And I thought, you know, because she had some big ideas about a nice thing that she was going to get. Come to find out, she found something used, secondhand. $200 is what it cost. She used our $200. Holy smokes. You could have just about, like, I had no more room in my cup. It was so full, right? Because she used that gift that we gave her. Exactly what it was for. It was just like, oh my, thank you, Lord. That was just so good, right? Yeah. She didn't squander the gift that we gave her and just let it sit there. I thought about preaching on the talents. You know, that would have been good. Somebody else can do that. It was too organized. I didn't know how to get my head around it. You are being invited. I better crack the going. It's like, holy smokes, 14 after 11. You are being invited into newness of life. It's not all going to hell in a handbasket. You're being invited. You are receiving an invitation from the Creator into newness of life, not hell in a handbasket. It's not always a Hallmark film either. But it sure as heck ain't hell in a handbasket, folks. Right? One of the people I follow, not on social, although they might be on social, says this. I picked this up years ago. As long as you're breathing, you know, this very physical, bodily-oriented activity of breathing, there is more right about you than wrong. So, folks, old, young, doesn't matter, just starting out, not taking care of your body, super taking care of your body, kind of obsessive about it. Maybe you've got body dysmorphia in one way or another. Who knows? As long as you're still breathing, there's more right about you than wrong. I wrote this down. Cleanliness is next to godliness. I promised myself, honey, I was not going to ask people to show of hands. Oh, no, okay, if I'm ever preaching and I say, okay, show of hands, don't raise your hand with me because I'm just going to get you, right? I'm just setting you up. So cleanliness is next to godliness, right? Don't raise your hands. Oh, yes, Pastor, that's right. Well, we don't act like it with our bodies, do we? Oh, man. Got 15 more minutes of this. We don't act like it with our bodies, do we? Like if I was working at an apartment building and had one of the apartments as a pay, you know, and I was in charge of maintenance, and I treated that building like some of us treat our bodies, I'd be fired. I'd be out living under a bridge. Right? Cleanliness. Is it next to godliness? I don't know. Y'all know. I'm just raising questions. I've got a whole bunch of really impertinent questions later, Pastor Jeb. Okay. Small shift. Rapture theology. Do not raise your hand and tell me that you are a fan of the rapture or dispensationalism. Just keep that to yourself because I'm about to hurt your feelings. Rapture theology. This is really important to me because I think it has set us up as a, especially as what many of you would think of in terms of that you, I don't know how you identify, if you identify as evangelical Christian or not. My assumption is that you probably do or some form of that or have in the past. So rapture theology has badly informed the majority of Protestant Christians to include evangelical Christianity. Rapture theology, and I'm just going to take this weight off of your shoulders, sir. No charge again, folks. Rapture theology is bad theology. It's escapist, and it leads to deprecating your bodies among a bunch of other creation-insensitive behaviors. If you think, I'm going to say you because I don't think this way. I used to. If you think that the place is just going to burn up in this eventual, hope it comes sooner than later, we all get to escape, and what's left just gets torn up in a big conflagration, right? Then why bother? Why bother with our bodies? Why bother with the dirty water that our kids are going to inherit? Why bother with all the trash laying out here on the streets? Why bother with our bad, stinky air? Why bother with, right? On and on and on and on and on. I went there. How in the world would you ever preach to this crew or any about environmental problems? It is so delicate. I'm going there. We deal with it with our bodies. Let's just make it personal, okay? Let's just make it personal. Let's forget about all that out there and the craziness. If I think that it doesn't matter what I do with this body because I'm just going to get sucked away eventually and hopefully soon, then it doesn't matter, right? Then in this case, like what we were taught as kids, cleanliness is next to godliness? No, dirtiness would be next to godliness at that point because God apparently is just going to burn it all up. Who cares? Short lesson. Idea of a rapture, as we typically understand it, this idea of rapture, give you a little bit of a historical context, it is not found in historic Christianity. It is simply not there. Oldest that we can get back to understanding any time that anybody thought about the rapture is 1830. My great-grandfather was born in 1860. Can you believe that? My dad's grandfather, 1860. The Civil War just started. 30 years before that is when this bad theology got out. It has everything to do with fundamentalists and what they call the tribulation and dispensationalism. It's a tiny little piece of bad teaching that has worked its way into our theological heads and out through our bodies. You know, it's interesting. I also thought, I've got 10 minutes left, folks. If we lived in a different place at a different time, this would not be a sermon because our concern would be so much more about just getting good drinking water and putting shelter over our heads, right? And we would have healthy bodies because I'd be walking all day long and I wouldn't be eating hardly anything. But for so many reasons, that's not where we're at. I think we love rapture theology in the church and in Christianity because it's simple. It's just simple. And it answers the question of, it just answers the question. It's a simple, simple answer to a very complex question. And why do we like simple answers over complex answers? Because we have a bias against the complex. Yeah, we do. We have complex bias. And then we'd have to actually live in this world and make it better. And that's hard. Yeah. But it's a lot easier. It's just a heck of a lot easier to throw up my hands and think, I'm going to be sucked away here soon anyway, and God's coming back, burn the whole thing up, and that'll be that. It's a lot harder and a lot more complex to have to actually take care of myself and the world around me. I better get cracking. And the fallout from all of that bad theology is literally earth-shattering. And if it's earth-shattering, then it becomes body-shattering too. I believe that that bad theology has, and our active living out of it is killing us, literally killing us. So, where do I start about this killing us and why we do what we do? Okay, here's some of the questions that I got. Just write them down if they sound interesting to you. Am I on target yet? Are you going to kick me out yet? He went back to check the tar to see if it's getting hot. So here's some questions for you as I wrap up. First question is, what is... Considering all these things that I've kind of thrown out at you and kind of letting you into my brain, and God's deep love for us, our desire to see with our eyes that we have been given, our desire to engage with this beautiful gift that we've been given and not just set it aside rudely, never attending to it, never using it, never enjoying it. Aside from all of the self-judgment that you have and the recrimination, self-recriminating thoughts that you have about what you're eating and not eating and how you're not exercising or doing all these things, right? Yeah. Ooh. First question is, what is the most loving thing that I can do for my body right now? Yeah. What's the most loving thing that I can do for my body right now? Maybe that's take a nap. Maybe you are... You chronically do not get enough sleep. Maybe it's just taking a nap, right? What's the most loving thing I can do for my body right now? Next question. Do you really want to stay the way you are? I mean, whatever. Right? Evs. I mean, I do care. I do care because I care about y'all. Because you're a fellow traveler in this beautiful creation we've been given. Right? This kingdom of God of which the veil is being pulled back just a little bit so we can see. But do you really want to stay the way you are? Do so. Don't do so. Next one. Why do we bemoan our life situation? We wring our hands as if we have no ability to change things. And then simply accept our circumstances as if we had no hope. Why do we do that? And I'm not just asking that like as an aside. Like I really am curious. Why do you do that? That's horrible behavior. And you thought I was going to talk bad about how y'all eating too many chips and holy smokes, getting whatever it is that they're cooking on those rolly things at the gas stations, right? Those are so good. Don't eat those. They will kill you. Next question. Why do we act like people with no hope? We're like the Israelites in the desert, so stubborn, right? So stubborn, snakes. Biting them. Had to get a stick, put a bronze serpent on it, right? But you had to know that there were some who simply refused to look at it. They had the answer. They had the problem. They had the answer. But you already know there's people like, oh, I ain't looking at that snake. I know my leg's all swolled up, but I ain't looking at it. You know there were people like that, right? We do the same thing. We have the problem. We see the remedy. We turn away from it. And then we bemoan it. Oh, poor me. Mm-mm. Look at that, Jeff. I totally controlled myself. I was going to say I'd call BS on that, but I won't say that out loud because that would not be appropriate in church. Thank you. Next question. Oh, I got to get cracking here. As a society and individuals, why have we chosen and bought into the notion of building capital, bank accounts, wealth, right? While on the whole, abandoning our physical well-being in exchange for financial well-being. Also, we act like we are going to physically die, kind of throwing up our hands and yet keep exercising our money as if it will live forever. Right? It's so weird. Yeah, we have chosen to exercise our money and not our persons. We are so interested in controlling. Oh my goodness. Ooh. Okay, remain seated for this. Why? This is more fun than I thought it was going to be. Oh, we're getting close. I've got 2 minutes left. I don't know what's going to happen here. We may go over just a couple minutes. I know you're all having a good time, though. Why? Oh, dear, this is a big one, but I just can't not say it. Why are we so interested? Listen to this one. Oh, my gosh. Why are we so interested in controlling other people's bodies and health decisions? And seemingly, we have no control over our own. Shame on us. Shame, shame, shame on us. Perhaps it's because we are so weak and could only pick out just tiny little things, like, I don't know, specks. Just little specks. That's all we can actually lift because we're so weak. We couldn't bear to pick up any logs, like what's sticking out of our own face. I'm just going to say it again, because this may be one of the best things I've said all day. Why are we so interested in controlling other people's bodies and health decisions, and seemingly we have no control over our own? That is just flagrant hypocrisy. But, Pastor, I'm not interested in words. No testimony, just behavior, just witness, right? Okay, I'll get off of this. Oh, no, I've got a couple more questions. Holy smokes. Oh, here's a good one. Why are we so averse to physical discomfort? Right? These just aren't stopping. What's happening here? Somebody pulled the plug on this thing. It's a battery. Why are we so averse to physical discomfort? Why are we so averse to limiting ourselves? Why are we so against limiting ourselves with food and comfort and the things that feel good, but that ultimately make us weak and will kill us? We're headed to the graveyard, but do we need to arrive there early? Right? What the heck? I'm going to get there first. It's like a race. Oh, yeah, and this is, ooh. Why do we deprecate our bodies? You know what deprecate means? Like talk down about or belittle or break down. Why do we deprecate our bodies? Why do we treat God's creation, oh my gosh. I don't know that y'all, I mean, you say you believe the Bible, okay. Why do we deprecate our bodies? Why do we treat God's creation and what he said was so good with so much derision? We exchange the original blessing in Genesis with a curse. We do that. You know we do that. I don't know if the dial is going to move, sir. I'm just trying to move the dial. I'm not trying to look at like from 0 to 100, folks. I'm just looking like from 0 to 10 maybe with y'all, right? We have an original blessing, and we treat it like a curse. Why do we think ourselves, here's another one, why do we think ourselves so incapable of simply taking a first step? Why do we think that the first step is so insignificant that each step is not actually everything? Each step is everything. Tiny, tiny baby step to all these big steps. It all matters. So, and I wrote down some possible action steps, tiny or not, assuming that you value having a healthy body. And gosh, this last one here I did here, you know, why do we think ourselves so incapable of taking a first step? Why do we think that first step is so insignificant? It reminds me of Mother Teresa's words about love. And this would, in this case, then, regarding ourselves. You know, she says, there are no great acts of love, just small acts of love with, small acts with great love, right? Don't have to do big things, just do small things with great love. Well, tiny little things for yourself with your health and your body, tiny little things with great love matter. They matter. Yeah, it matters. So, how can you begin? Where am I here? Oh, I'm almost done, folks. Good news. How can you begin to act on the values you have for physical well-being and health? I know y'all care about your health. You really do. I mean, you're all wearing decent clothes. They appear to be clean, at least. Right? You combed your hair. I don't smell any of you overtly. I haven't been too close, but right? So you kind of take care of yourselves. So I know you must care at some level, right? Just objectively, the data I'm gathering, you care at some level. So take what you got for little bits of care, add this to it. How you can begin to act with these values that you have for physical care and well-being and health. How can you do this without being bogged down by inabilities and life circumstances? Because you all have limitations. I have limitations. You got life circumstances, right? And you have all kinds of inabilities. Physical limitations, absolutely. What are the next steps? So I really would like for you to be able to, when you leave here today, be thinking about and then acting on connecting your head, because it's up here. You know this already. It's up here. You know it. I want you to connect it. We're going to be practicing connecting this with here, with your heart, and then out through your body, okay? This, again, it's the whole testimony and witness difference. Like, don't just be keeping it up here or out your mouth. Get it down to here so it can go out your body as witness. Connecting your head with your heart and then with your body. Oh, yeah. It said here, tell about the mountains revealing us. Yeah. So, be prepared. If you take on any physical challenge, and you probably have already experienced this, and that's probably why you're not doing it, that any type of physical activity that becomes uncomfortable for you will very quickly reveal who you really are. Any physical activity that you take on that is uncomfortable for you, and that's what you should be doing, is the uncomfortable activity, it will very quickly reveal who you are. In the mountains, we say that a person just is laid bare. You cannot hide who you really are in the mountains, because it is so hard and so challenging. You have nothing but to expose yourself. You have to expose yourself to survive and to be present. There's no option. Yeah. And if you try to not, it's dangerous. You'll fail in the mountains. You will not make it. If you try to hold it all together, it'll reveal you. It forces what's inside outside.
Yeah.
It's so beautiful and uncomfortable. So, in little tiny ways, your tiny little mountains, maybe it's going for a walk around the block. Maybe you're going to start that today after you get done picking yourself up off the floor from all the things that hurt your feelings from when I preached today. Right? I pushed some of your buttons. I'm sorry. Not sorry, Pastor Jeb. You'll start moving and you'll start exercising if that's what you want to do. And it will be uncomfortable and you'll get frustrated and it will reveal you to yourself. Right? Maybe there'll be some chafing and it will be uncomfortable. Let's just go with chafing. It'll be uncomfortable. And you'll be complaining about it. And you'll be like, how come I this and this? And then you'll start getting upset and angry and frustrated and you don't have that and everything. And oh my gosh, it'll start revealing yourself. It'll reveal to you who you are. And it's not nice. Nobody wants to see that. Ain't nobody got no time for that. Right? Push toward it. If it's uncomfortable, push toward it. If it reveals who you really are, push toward it. If it's scary as heck and you don't want to do it anymore, have courage and push toward it. It's okay to not like it, and it's okay to be fearful. It's okay that things don't taste good and they are physically uncomfortable. It is okay to not like it and to do it anyway. It's called having courage. Yeah. Just be courageous and do it anyway. At whatever ability level you can. Until later on you can do it even better. Oh, yeah. Tell about the mountains, what they reveal to us. Oh, my gosh, I'm 10 minutes over. Sorry, guys. Physical activity lays everything bare, forces us to see inside ourselves. So earthy. It is so earthy and gross and dirty when we exercise and when we start physically moving and doing stuff. It is so dirty and gross and stinky. It is, right? So earthy. Can't stand it. No. But you know who can stand that? You know who really, really likes it? Somebody said it. God does. Yeah, God made it. God said it was good. God blessed it. God blessed it. Everything in this earth, God blessed and said is good. Yeah. Perhaps it's just your way of thinking and seeing that is bad. Maybe you have, maybe you got eyes and can't see. Maybe you have ears and can't hear. Nothing wrong with that. You can still see better later. You can learn to hear, right? Okay, almost done. Oh, yeah. Ooh. The shadows come into the light painfully. Talk about the shadow we cast, how it must be attended to. Oh, yeah. You know, as I'm sitting here, if I were outside, the sun, it's probably right about there somewhere, it would be casting a shadow, right? The shadow... we all have some shadowy stuff, and the sun really reveals it. So, but we typically don't attend to the shadow. We attend to everything else light around it. Start looking at your shadow. Start looking at the dark parts. Yeah, let the sun reveal them. Be courageous. See it. Be scared. Be fearful. Don't like it. It's stinky. It's smelly. It hurts. And move toward it. Oh, here's the encouragement of the day. I actually wrote encouragement for the day. I waited till the end. So good. Begin a physical movement. Anything. Just do something, people. Holy smokes. Okay. Does anybody here want to brag? This would be a good show of hands. Anybody here do some type of physical movement for their physical well-being on a some type of regular basis? Yes, I love it. Perfect. Okay, I love it. Yes, I see that hand. I see that hand. See, this is the kind of salvation I'm talking about for today. God sees it and loves it too. My encouragement to you, for everybody that raised their hand, step it up just a tiny little notch so it becomes slightly uncomfortable. Just a little teeny bit uncomfortable, a little bit more. Let's say you're walking for 20 minutes. Walk for 25 minutes. Just start stretching a little bit more, right? If that hurts and starts becoming uncomfortable, well, walk for that 20 minutes and then do something else physical for another 5 minutes or 10 minutes. Just add to it, right? Be creative. And for all of you who didn't raise your hand, any type of movement. Just start using your gift. Just start using your gift. Unless you just want to keep putting it back on the shelf somewhere and cover it up with a bunch of other tchotchkes that you've acquired over time that you don't care less about. Okay, what do I got on here? Oh, yeah, begin a physical movement. Feel it. Then, when you're feeling it, because you're going to feel it, give it to the one who made you feel that way. Give it to your Creator. Yeah, make it a prayer. Make it a prayer time. Make it a spiritual thing. You're connecting your head and your heart to your body. Practice being spiritually present as you move. Simple, small things done with great love towards yourself. Okay, may I give the benediction or do you want to?
I want to.
You do it.
Now, I want to say this, and I want you to raise your hand because I know, one, Eric can take it, and two, I think it's good for you. How many of you felt uncomfortable today about something? Kim's like, yep, me. Eric felt uncomfortable. Here is the truth, church. Sometimes when we feel uncomfortable, it reveals things that have been concealed with us. Sometimes if we disagree with something, it's a great opportunity in that moment to go, hey, this made me uncomfortable. Why? And can I invite you as the church and the family of God that the things that make you uncomfortable are great things to talk about, to have conversation about, and to ask the question, why did that make me feel that way? It's an invitation, and I appreciate the way that Eric brought some stuff up because I sat there and went, ooh, that makes me, you know, that just makes me squirm a little bit, and it makes me ask why. Couple other things that I love that Eric brought up. One, he talked about our actions over our words. And I want to put it in this perspective for you. If I told you every single day I go to the gym, right? I go to the gym, I go to the gym, I go to the gym. I want to ask you this. How long of me saying that with no physical change would it take for you to start to question that? I go to the gym, I go to the gym, I go to the gym. But if you don't see it lived out, you're going to go, I'm not sure he does, right? I mean, that's the reality, and I think what Eric was really trying to pinpoint with that is as Christians, if we say, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian, I'm a Christian, but you don't see the physical change, and you don't see the way that people are moving and forming, then people are going to go, are they? Because it's not that we don't have things to work on, but it's that we want God to be changing our heart. So I love the way that Eric brought out that we need to live our faith. And we need to show it in the way that we move and that we are the hands and feet of Jesus. So today as we prepare to go, I hope you were challenged. I hope that maybe you felt a little bit uncomfortable about something. And if you did, can I encourage you at lunch have a conversation with someone about it? Go, why did that affect me? Why is that? Is it because I disagree with Eric? And if so, great. I hope that you found more support for it. Or maybe if you go, oh, that affected me because that's something that I know that I need to be working on. But church, I believe that we are responsible as the family of God. And as adults, that we can have hard conversations. and that we can talk through things and we can think about things and really process them through well. So can I invite you today to process through well what you heard? Eric, thank you. You really challenged me today. Let's pray. Jesus, Lord, we want to be healthy people. Lord, as we're coming to an end of our healthy living series, and as we are preparing and looking forward towards Easter, Lord, we've had challenges. We've had challenges about our spiritual health, about forgiveness, about our mental health, about overcoming addiction, and now our physical health. And Jesus, we want to be good stewards of what you have given us. God, from the very beginning, you commanded us to have ownership, to be good stewards of everything on this earth, including our own bodies. So Lord, as we wrestle today, as we go home asking questions, Lord, may you open our hearts to what areas you want to work on. So Lord, may we go in your peace. May we go in your grace. In your name we pray, Lord. Amen. You are dismissed. May you have a blessed rest of your Sunday.